Now, this is a very controversial story, and I have learned that this is a regular story around not necessarily Franz Jägerstätter. I'm not sure if I'm saying his name right, but doesn't it sound good? Jägerstätter. You know? What'd you say?
Oh, I didn't say anything. I
Okay.
was just about to praise you because I think you pronounced it beautifully. But
Thanks.
I also know no German, so you
Yeah.
know.
She knows French
The
though.
blind leading the blind
Yes.
here. Yeah.
But then you also have Rudolf, who's one of the most evil people to have walked the planet. And the interesting thing about this is that both of them are tempted. And Franz Jägerstätter has a movie that was made of him, and it's called A Hidden Life. And I'm just going to play the trailer real quick for you.
I had a dream. I thought that we could build our nest high up in the trees. Fly away like birds to the mountains. Swear loyalty to Hitler.
Do you think your defiance will change the course of things?
I can't do what I believe is wrong. We have to stand up to evil. What's happened to our country? To the land we love?
You cannot say no to your race and your home. You are a traitor.
Whatever you do, I'm with you. Always.
Now that's a good movie. So if you haven't seen that movie, you just need to drop right now. You just need to go get it. It's worth every penny. It is about Franz, and he's up, I believe, for canonization as a saint. And the reason why this is such a good I think example for what we're talking about today is because, ultimately Rudolf Hess comes in and after the Nazis are basically conquered, he's on trial. And that's that picture that you see in this original shot right here is that's Rudolf on the right. He is or Hoss, I guess you would say. And he is on trial at the Nuremberg trials, the famous trials that basically said, you guys violated laws above the German laws. And his concern apparently was that he was going to go to jail and he was going to be treated as bad as the rest of the, as he treated the people in Auschwitz. And this is what he said before he died. In the Polish prisons, I experienced for the first time what human kindness is. Despite all that has happened, I have experienced humane treatment, which I could never have expected and which has deeply shamed me. I have inflicted terrible wounds on humanity. I have caused unspeakable suffering for the Polish people in particular. I am to pay for this with my life. May the Lord forgive me one day, forgive one day what I have done. And the reason why this is a tough topic is because everybody, when they hear about what happened, because he ultimately comes back to God. And I'll tell that story in a minute. He was in charge of Auschwitz. He eventually, joins the Nazis early on. He climbs the ranks. He becomes the head of Auschwitz and basically the implementer of the final solution in Auschwitz. And while there, millions and millions of people die. And there's a priest, and I can't remember his name. I should, but he's a Jesuit. The Jesuits were, if you read a Jesuit from the 50s, man, they really are admirable Christian men. And so a Jesuit snuck into Auschwitz to give mass to the prisoners, and apparently Hoss found him and didn't kill him and let him go. After he is arrested. Hoss, that is, you know, he is put in prison and people treat him really well. And he comes to the realization that he needs forgiveness, that he needs confession. And I want to talk about, as we're going through this, I want you to think about the difference between Hoss's confession, which is going to be along the lines of the Catholic sacraments, and this idea that somebody can just go to a church, get baptized, and boom, they're in the club. And the reason why I think that this is important is because the sacraments actually bring to the fore the mystery of contrition. We don't know if Hoss was truly contrite or not, if he just says, I believe. But he begins to request a priest before he dies because he was baptized as a Catholic and he wants to do this, but they can't find anybody who speaks German. And so finally they find one, and it's the priest that Hoss could have killed but didn't. And Hoss gives, and there's, you know, variations on this story, but bottom line is that this is the priest who comes in and hears his confession. Apparently the confession was for hours and hours and hours. And you know, just Google this. It's a pretty crazy story. You know, I'm skipping over some facts. And he gives Hoss his last reception of the Eucharist, Viaticum, and then Hoss goes and is hung at the gallows. In fact, the gallows, if you go on the Wikipedia page, are still there where he died. And the question is, is he still in heaven? Did he go? Did God actually forgive him of his sins? And that's an uncomfortable question, because we see all the millions of people that he killed, and we want there to be a limit to mercy, because, you know, if we can blame one man for Auschwitz, that's a lot easier than recognizing that that one man was forged in a culture that was basically demonic because of the will of the people. So the issue is well, who does Hoss just represent himself? It's not like he came down in an alien spaceship and said, let us make Auschwitz and let's just kill everybody. You know, this is the slippery slope. You know, people like to say the slippery slope fallacy. It's like, well, obviously people don't just wake up one day and find concentration camps. So we know that in some sense there's something slippery, just might not be the slope. Maybe it's our will. We don't know. But maybe that's what we should call it, the slippery will fallacy. You know, it's not a slippery slope. You're just a slippery guy, you know. But then we look at a quote from Gordon Zahn, who was the biographer for Franz. And he went and visited Franz's local town and started asking him, you know, this is a pretty crazy story. You know, Franz wouldn't take an oath to Hitler. He ends up in jail. There's now a movie about him. You know, it's a beautiful story, but it's a painful story. And Franz says, this is what the people say about Franz when the biographer starts to research his life. Franz Jägerstätter is generally remembered kindly, even lovingly. This does not mean that the villagers were ready to give any significant approval to his actions, though. Few were willing even to entertain the possibility that he acted as a man in his position should. Yet almost everyone I approached began with unquestionably sincere assertion that he had been a Leiber Mensch, a wonderful guy, and that his death was a terrible tragedy. Now, the thing that is interesting about this is that no one wanted to say he did the right thing. In the same way, nobody wants to say that Hoss had his sins forgiven. And I think that this highlights a situation when there are really bad atrocities. We want a name to the face. We want the criminal. We want them to get what they deserve. And that's that desire and that thirst for justice. But at the same time, we also have to recognize, well, are there limits to mercy? And if we judge Hoss and say, well, God can't forgive him, he can't forgive him, well, who produced Hoss? Is God going to look at them and say, well, you didn't have any fault? You know, that time that you could have helped the Jews and you decided not to because you were afraid of Hoss, I'm going to let that one slide. Or what about the fact that some of these kids that grew up to join the Nazis may have persecuted Jews because their parents said that it was okay? Is that, or they didn't stop him at least. You know, they just let it happen. Did that have an impact on Höss and what he did? You know, it's pretty clear that God judges nations as well as individuals. And right now, we're in a moment where Christians are afraid to speak up. They're afraid to speak up at their jobs. They're afraid to say what they believe is true, not just for themselves, but for what God intended. And they're going to places like Disney World and saying, ah, I know that Disney doesn't really like Christians, but, you know, it's a great place for kids. Yeah, but they hate your faith. They don't want you to have a place in the public sector if you're going to say that gay marriage is a sin. Or what about YouTube? You know, I'm a small channel right now, but if I could get flagged just for that. Hey, you can't say that. And now, you know, what platform is my best platform suddenly is gone because I've decided to say what I know to be true, that marriage is between a man and a woman. Or what about people who say, you know, it's not really that bad. You know, we're not in that bad of a culture. You know, people are just blowing it out of proportion. I mean, that guy lost his job. He should have lost his job. I mean, why would you even say that at work? You know, well, what did he say? Well, that a man is a man and a woman is a woman. Well, what's wrong with that? I don't know. I mean, I guess the reason why he said it was because his daughter got hurt in a soccer match because a boy decided to come in and play against her. But, you know, I mean, he can keep that to himself. The reason why Höss is a challenge for Christians is because we know that cowardice is what produces evil men. And people like Franz, we don't like them either because they're an example of what happens when you do the right thing. Both men, in a very short period of time, ended up dying. One at the beginning, roughly, of World War II, maybe right in the middle, and one at the end. I mean, a matter of like 6 years. And in terms of eternity, that's not very much. So how are we supposed to answer this? Like let's say we assume that Höss is actually in heaven. How can that be just? Well, part of this is that there has to be rewards in heaven. Nobody wants to talk about that. Everybody wants to talk about this moral indifference. But it's very clear from Scripture that, like, outside, beyond even salvation, there will be rewards in heaven. That what you did here is going to store up treasures in heaven. Store up treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy. Don't store up treasures here on earth. Well, how do I become holy? Well, it's pretty clear from the epistles that you do that through obedience. Even the Bible says, you know, I don't desire sacrifice, I desire obedience. Obedience to what? Whatever you ate that morning? You know, when we look at guys in the military and we look at what they do, especially if you've ever watched Band of Brothers or anything like that, or you've watched any World War II movie, and you know that these guys, especially guys who were dealing with racism during that time, they loved their country and they fought for it anyway. They had bad generals. They had bad leaders. They had abusive leaders who made their life-threatening jobs difficult. And they didn't defect from the military. They stayed in the military. They stayed loyal to the institution. They didn't abandon it. They stayed the course and focused on the mission because they understood that the mission was only going to be attained by an institution. It wasn't going to be attained by them just going off starting their own military. That would be impossible. But there are plenty of people who have done that. But if everybody had gone and said, you know what, forget this. We don't need to help out those people over there. We don't need to do any of this kind of stuff. We wouldn't have had stories like Band of Brothers. The world would look very different. And so when we consider, okay, well, what makes, you know, this kind of at least somewhat settled in our minds? First foremost, there has to be some concept of rewards. Franz was the better Christian, hands down. Like, it's not even close. And Höss, well, we won't know until we get there. But what ultimately ends up happening with Höss is that his conversion is ultimately a stumbling block to the Protestant and foolishness to the world. The Protestant says, you know, there's no power in the sacraments. It doesn't matter. Okay, well then those same Protestants are often, well, not those exact ones, but when you say, well, this person who is in the porn industry and all this kind of stuff, she just woke up one day and after picking up her Bible, decided she was going to be a Christian, went and got baptized. Is she a Christian? Well, you know, we got to kind of wait. We got to kind of wait on that one. Okay. Well, what about a guy who went to confession for hours and hours and hours? There's a priest there who's heard this. The priest is now making a judgment about whether or not this person should receive the sacrament, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And Christ himself said, you know, if you do not eat my flesh and drink my blood, you do not have life in you. And so what ends up happening with Haas's conversion is that the mystery of contrition suddenly starts to come into focus. Well, how powerful is this mercy? Because we're looking at it through the sacraments, not just through somebody claiming that they are now saved. We know that those sacraments have an objective purpose. They are a sign of an effective grace, a grace that happens every time. And we don't know if Haas's conversion was sincere. But the sacraments force us to have to wrestle with his conversion much harder than some random OnlyFans girl online. And when we consider what St. Paul says, I think it's applicable here. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. St. Paul, former murderer of Christians. And so for those people out there who think that, you know, at the end of the day, nobody can be saved, you know, there's a limit to sins, you know, ultimately, if you rack up a high score, you know, you get that achievement, you're out. Life is short and eternity is a lot longer. And the way you answer that question depends on which one you feel more, eternity or the present. And so anyway, yeah. So let me know what you think. Do you think that Franz was the better guy? Do you think Rudolph, do you think he's in heaven? Let me know. Let me know what you think about what I just said. We're going to get into questions now. And before we do that, I've got a couple more questions that came in. So appreciate you guys sending those or asking me over the phone or whatever. I really do appreciate it. Make sure you check out Rugged Rosaries. You get a promo code for 10% off. So before we jump into the questions, make sure you check these guys out. They are really great. They're based out of Texas. And I just really enjoy their rosaries. You need to give them a good look. They're really durable. They make them with like paracord and all that stuff. What did you say?
I just wanted to add, we are not getting a kickback for these.
Yeah, we don't get a kickback.
This is not for it's true. Our own.
We do get a kickback if you buy these awesome mugs though, but I don't want to cross brand. So right now we're talking about rosaries. So make sure you do that. 10% off, support people, the small businesses like that. I think it's really important, especially now when we need so much prayer. All right. So we're going to go to question number one. Suppose that technology existed that removed the act of sex but still produced the child without any collateral abortions. Would this kind of IVF still be permissible? And the answer is no. And this question, you know, is ultimately based on what do you think sex is for? Is it, and also what do you think fertility is? Is it a disease that needs to be cured? Or is it a state of life that God has for a person so that they can ultimately do his will somewhere else? That those are important questions. But outside of that, even the process, it's not merely that the loss of embryos is the only evil that's occurring. You know, the whole process is usually when these questions are asked, it's generally something, it's not that people aren't smart, but they're just not aware of the process. You know, the stress on the female body is very, very, very hard. They're pumped with hormones. I've known people who have gone through this that I worked with at one back in a past life. It's a very, very difficult procedure. I've known a lot of people who have either gone through IVF or gone through surrogacy, and it's a challenge on the whole couple the whole time. And this is a lot more prevalent than you would think. I mean, I've known people who are at ministries who are doing surrogacy to actually pay, to actually afford to do the ministry. Like, this is a serious problem. And so there's a lot more that goes on in this whole process. And one of them is just the prudential side of things. Like the moment you say, hey, you know, fertility is a disease that we need to cure. Well, with technology, well, now what you've done is you've opened up the door to the fact that, well, if we can cure it for infertile couples, why can't we cure it for homosexuals and lesbians? Why can't we do that? That's a real problem. And so you're going to run into an issue on that subject, just from a practical political standpoint. If you take the morality out of it for a minute and you just say, okay, well, politically, what kind of laws are going to come for this? It's a real issue. But secondly, children are not supposed to be conceived by virtue of technology. They're supposed to be conceived by love. And so if you divorce the act of marriage, which is what it is, this is the consummation of marriage that is objectively verified by the presence of a child. And children are not just a political unit or a biological unit. They're a spiritual unit. They are incarnate beings. We're not just sacks of meat. We don't have to just, you know, it's not like we need a mom and a dad just so that we feel good. It's because that's the way God intended for this to happen. Thirdly, there are sins involved, like masturbation, that have to happen in order for this process to occur. And this ultimately gets at, well, what do you think, you know, if in this area, which, by the way, you even have biblical justification and natural law justification to say, yeah, it's probably, if you're just a betting person, you shouldn't actually go through with these processes. Because, you know, if sin really could lead to death, if there really are such things as mortal sins, you know, which you won't know until you get there, then, you know, we probably want to, you know, err on the side of caution. And so when we limit it down to just one to one, yeah, you've eliminated, you know, some of the collateral damage. It's just become a lesser evil in some sense. But it also forgets that you can't start off with one to one because technology has to be iterative. And so, like, you have to start with losing a lot of children so that you can develop this technology. And the question becomes, okay, well, let's say we continue to develop this technology and we actually get better at having babies outside of the womb rather than in it. What's to say that moms and dads now have to actually have children by the natural processes and not adopt the baby maker 3000 that they put in their garage? This is a legitimate concern down the road. And people always say, well, slippery slope, slippery slope, slippery slope. Well, if you could, hypothetically speaking, develop a technology that required zero pain, zero consequence to the mother and the father, and they could just have children without the marital act, why should they have children with the marital act? Why not just do it the easy and expensive way? So that's how I would answer that one. But you guys let me know. Like, what do you think? And then we've got another question here. Biden claims to be a good Catholic, but his policies don't align with Catholic teaching. Some Catholics have said that he separates his Catholic beliefs from his political strategy to maintain a separation of church and state, but also because strategically he saw an opening in the Democratic Party and is just representing them, even though their platform is anti-Catholic. What do you think of this argument? Similarly, if Trump is doing the same thing, can Christians justify voting for him if he is doing the same thing with the Conservative Party? This ultimately is, I don't think works, because like we were saying before, you know, the devil approaches Christ and says, hey, if you want, you can have all these kingdoms. And Christ is on a mission. Okay. He's on a mission to spread the good news. And, you know, I think it's a valid interpretation to say, well, the devil is offering Christ a shortcut to accomplish his mission here. And it's an implicit, are you going to do the will of the Father, or are you going to do what I'm presenting to you? And ultimately, you know, Catholic teaching matters, not because Biden is supposed to be some sort of theological dictator, but because Biden should want to go to heaven. Like, his soul needs to work out its salvation with fear and trembling. And how can he do that if he's allowing himself to use political power to advocate for things like abortion, to advocate for things like, you know, the student loan forgiveness and those kinds of things? Like, how can he do those kinds of things if ultimately he is a Catholic? You know, now I know some Catholics will be like, well, student loan forgiveness isn't a big deal. That's okay, fine, we'll give you that. But at the end of the day, on abortion or gay marriage or any of these issues, He's claiming to be a Catholic. And here's the deal. Like, Catholics are held to a higher standard than more than any other denomination. Just look at the fact that everybody still remembers the Catholic sex scandals, but everybody's forgotten about the other denominations that had just as much. So, you know, well, not maybe not just as much, but certainly enough to warrant criticism and public, you know, condescension and notoriety. So being a Catholic, if you're going to claim you're the one church that Jesus founded and you're not going to follow the rules of that church, well, then, you know, you're held to a higher standard. I think you're in the wrong. Now, on the subject of Trump, you know, can you still vote for Trump on these kinds of things? Because Trump is saying that he's a Christian, you know, all this kind of stuff. Well, nobody knows what kind of Christian Trump is. And the word Christian now has, at this point in America's history, has lost all its meaning. Somebody says they're a Christian, they could literally be saying that they're pro-choice, pro-evolution, pro-gay marriage, and pro-government mandating a vaccine that violates your conscience and your bodily rights. Is that a Christian? Probably not, based on what traditional Christian teaching actually says, or what the authority of the church says, morally speaking. Some people will say, well, can you be a Catholic and support abortion? Well, I mean, in some sense, yeah, because you're actually under the judgment of the church. So if you're a Catholic that supports abortion, well, you're in mortal sin. You know, that's the deal. So in that sense, yeah, you can be a Catholic and support abortion. It's just that you're out of a state of grace and you don't want to be there. So you need to go to confession, confess, and then, you know, get contrite and change your views. And the last thing, though, is where I think these questions ultimately go, though, is, you know, can you actually vote for these individuals? You know, can a Christian justify voting for these individuals? And I'm not going to tell you one way or another which one you can vote for. The question ultimately is, well, is it wrong for a political candidate to be politically strategic in order to maintain his political position so that he can do more good than another? Well, it just depends on what he's calling good, because the Bible is very clear that people will call evil good and good evil. And as we saw earlier, it certainly seems like that might be a line that they're flirting with on this IVF and pro-life issue. If you're going to say that it's the pro-choicers who are actually trying to keep the country together, and it's those pesky pro-lifers who are, you know, really trying to make things difficult and be divisive and all this stuff. I mean, after all, why can't we just kill a couple kids in order to make life a little better for everyone? Well, I'm just saying, you know, you probably don't want those people discussing whether or not you should be unplugged if you're in a car accident, you know, especially if you have a lot of money. You know, they're probably going to say, hey, look, like, if we let Uncle Ronnie go, you know, all of our lives are going to be a little bit better, you know, all of us. You know, you don't want Donald Trump sitting there, you know, talking about your end of life care. And then I think that is going to be it for today. So, cause we are sitting at like an hour 20. So I am really trying to get this down to like 60 minutes flat, but I'm obviously still working on it, but I really appreciate everybody, listening in. It looks like we had more listeners this time than we did before. And so appreciate you all listening. Don't forget to follow, like, subscribe, comment. Please let me know what you think about all these things that we discussed. And I will catch you next time. I'm Daniel Roberts. And don't forget, keep thinking.